A group of conservative evangelicals are now rallying around the president following a scathing op-ed in Christianity Today, which called for President Trump's removal from office. In a letter to the magazine's president, nearly 200 church leaders condemned the op-ed, writing this: "We are not far-right evangelicals as characterized by the author. Rather, we are Bible-believing Christians and patriotic Americans. Your editorial offensively questioned the spiritual integrity and Christian witness of tens of millions of believers who take seriously their civic and moral obligations." Here to discuss now, we have Father Edward Beck and Sarah Posner, who is the author of the forthcoming book, Unholy: Why White Evangelicals Worship at the Altar of Donald Trump. And Sarah, you wrote recently a New York Times op-ed titled "The Christianity Today Editorial Won't Change Anything." Tell us why.
Well, Christianity Today is a flagship magazine for evangelical America, founded by Billy Graham in the 1950s. But since the magazine was founded six decades ago, evangelicalism has changed a lot. There have been a lot of sub-movements and new religious movements within evangelicalism that we now see rallying around President Trump. New political organizations, new types of organizing, televangelism, new kinds of media. So a magazine like Christianity Today doesn't have the singular resonance that it might have had back in the 50s, 60s, or even the 70s. And so when you see these 200 evangelical leaders who are pushing back on Christianity Today, that is the evangelical America that supports Donald Trump. It is the mainstream of evangelicalism. 80% of evangelicals, white evangelicals, oppose impeaching President Trump. And these leaders who wrote that letter are strong supporters, the strongest supporters of President Trump, and they represent those voters.
And Father Beck, the head of Christianity Today, says they actually, they did lose some subscribers. That's important to note. But he said that they ended up with gaining three times as many new subscriptions after calling for Trump's removal. I mean, what do you make of that? And what do you make of whether this is just something that is kind of a blip on the radar or that more people could actually be affected by an op-ed like this?
Well, Brianna, first of all, Christianity Today is a centrist magazine, certainly not far left, as the president has kind of said it is. And I think a lot of what Sarah says is correct. But even in your introduction, evangelicals are Bible-believing Christians. And if you take the Bible as a whole, you are hard-pressed, I think, evangelicals, some of them are saying now, especially younger ones, to continue to support this president. So I think what we are seeing are cracks in that support, because issues like immigration and the treatment of migrants, the environment, these count especially to young evangelicals. The Ten Commandments, even hard, fast evangelicals. I mean, what about the Eighth Commandment, bearing false witness, which is equivalently lying? I mean, the president has been shown to have lied a lot. So do those who believe in the Bible or the Seventh Commandment against adultery, do they simply toss all of that out because of a few issues that they think are more important, like abortion or the appointment of Supreme Court judges? I don't think so. I think what we're going to see is a further erosion, because though 80% of white evangelicals may have voted for this president, now this president has been in office for quite some time and has done things that a lot of those who voted for him no longer agree with and would not support again.
Sarah, I know you say, yeah, there's a crack, but it was there all along. There's a group of evangelicals who don't agree with the president, and yet it's a very small slice of the overall evangelical pie. When you hear Father Beck sort of outlining some of the issues that are confronting all voters, and I think, look, a lot of voters are full of contradictions, mm-hmm. right? It's hard always to understand. They believe in one thing, but their actions say another thing. How do you make sense of where evangelicals are on reconciling what they think is important morally and then supporting someone who very clearly goes against a lot of the things that they say they believe in?
Well, for the white evangelicals who are supporting President Trump and supporting him through every scandal and controversy of his presidency, this is really more about their power than it is about morality. They say it's about morality, and they say it's about their religious freedom or opposing abortion or saying that LGBT rights infringes on their religious liberty, but they have gained a lot of political power during Trump's presidency. It's not just the judges that he's appointed. It's not just the policies that he's created. It's that he's let them create the policies. He's appointed conservative evangelicals to be cabinet secretaries. He's appointed them to important political appointments in agencies like the Department of Health and Human Services and the Department of Justice that are making key policy. And they are, what's very important to them is that they are the drivers of this policy, of these policies, and they have power in this presidency. So they're willing to overlook any wrongdoing by the president because they believe he was chosen by God to save America at this time, and that he's giving them the power to do it by giving them the tools of government with which to do these policy changes.
Father Beck?
And yet, they follow a Jesus who opposes the abuse and misuse of political power. So I think you're hard-pressed to say that that is a Christian following. Also, I think if you look at what the teaching of Jesus is, say, what is salvation? Who gets saved? That's only in Matthew 25 in the Christian scriptures. And the criteria, did you feed the hungry? Did you clothe the naked? Did you visit the imprisoned? It's all about compassion to the outcast, to the poor. So if that's the criterion, and that is scripturally based, how do you as a Christian say that this doesn't matter? This is what Jesus says is most important about getting into the kingdom. How do you say that doesn't matter? As a Christian, I don't think you can simply focus on power and say this is good for us. What about the humility Jesus teaches? What about the powerlessness that Jesus teaches? And I think these are key issues to keep in mind when we're looking at this predicament.
Such an important conversation. Father Beck, Sarah Posner, thank you.